I've always thought it was interesting how we all view things differently. I am very detail-oriented when it comes to research pertaining to topics covered on the channel, but in my day-to-day life, I have tunnel vision. I pay very little attention to what's going on around me. Just this afternoon, my girlfriend was all excited because she spent the day reorganizing everything in the house. She asked me to come inside the laundry room at one point. I stand there for a second or two, wondering what the hell I'm supposed to be looking at. She asked if I noticed any changes. I said no. She then pointed to all the extra space from the things she had moved out of the laundry room. All of a sudden, I noticed the change. She can notice things in the house that I would never pay attention to. Now, this concept also applies to the mainstream media when it comes to television ratings for the NBA. I don't know if I see details in the ratings that the media doesn't see. I don't know if it's negligence on their part and they're just going out of their way to make the NBA look better. Either way, whatever the case may be, it is abundantly clear at this point, me and the mainstream media view NBA ratings completely different. Last year, the NBA set record low ratings on Christmas Day, but you wouldn't have known that if you listened to the mainstream media. Headline at The Athletic from December 29th, 2021. NBA gets modest Christmas TV numbers as NFL destroys all competition. Modest? Modest? The numbers last year were absolutely god-awful. The good news, though, for the NBA going into this year, ratings had nowhere to go but up, right? Right? That would be the case if you listen to the media. Unfortunately for the NBA, we don't lie here on the channel. We don't polish your turd to make it look appetizing. We give you the truth. Headline at deadline. NBA Christmas Day games generate ratings highs for ESPN and ABC. Headline at Sports Media Watch. NBA Christmas viewership up despite the NFL. This is yet another example of the media giving you a partial truth without giving you the full story. Although I will credit Sports Media Watch. They didn't necessarily polish the turd, they just washed it off a little bit. Deadline, on the other hand, was in full polish mode. They didn't point out the overwhelming negatives in these numbers. They tried to pull off an old coaching trick: accentuate the positives, hide the negatives. NBA viewership on Christmas Day was up 5% over the record low ratings from last year. Now, this was helped by the fact for the first time ever, ABC broadcast all five games on Christmas Day. They were also simulcast on ESPN. Now, if you compare these numbers to 2020, the NBA was actually down 4%, which I thought was alarming. I don't understand why no one else is pointing this out. 2020 was the worst year, arguably, in the history of the NBA. The league was fully embracing the art of fellatio. Players across the NBA got down on their knees before games, opening their mouths wide to accept the love of the oak tree. Black Lives Matter was painted all over the court on the back of jerseys. Hell, I'm sure some players got the shit tattooed on their face. Just 2 months prior, they had set record low ratings for the NBA Finals. Christmas Day 2020 was viewed as a disaster, but it was blamed on the COVID. The record low ratings last year blamed on COVID protocols. What is the excuse this year? Why is the NBA failing to top the low ratings in 2020 and barely topping the record lows in 2021? What is the excuse? The truth is, there is no excuse. This league, the media, they're out of excuses at this point. All five games aired on broadcast television, and you're still barely drawing respectable numbers? Let's look at the positives first, then we'll get into the negatives, which I'm going to try to turn into positives. Bucks-Celtics was the most watched game of the day, 6 million viewers, up 16% from Suns-Warriors last year. This was the first time since the mid-90s the most watched game didn't feature Michael Jordan, Kobe Bryant, or LeBron James. Sixers-Knicks, 4 million viewers. Now, the media is pointing to the fact that this was the most watched early window game since 2011, but that's only because the early game typically airs on cable, not broadcast television. Suns-Nuggets averaged 2.5 million, the most watched late game since 2015, but again, This comes with a caveat because late games are typically on ESPN. Three of the five games on Christmas Day saw double-digit increases in the ratings. So how come ratings were only up 5% overall from last year and down 4% compared to 2020? Because the supposed two most popular teams in the league, the supposed biggest draws, completely shit the bed. Lakers Mavs, 4.3 million, down 12% from Celtics Bucks last year. LeBron James, the superstar, the enigma, the king of queefs, the deity all NBA fans worship. Yeah. This dude drew the smallest midday audience on Christmas since his first Christmas game back in 2003. A low ratings record set by LeBron James in 03 was broken by him in 2022. Yet for some reason, the NBA continues shoving him down our throat. Golden State Warriors didn't perform any better. The Warriors have been the biggest draw in the NBA for the last 5 or 6 years. And to be fair, they didn't have Steph Curry this past Sunday, but with Steph Curry tag-teaming the cucumber, that could be viewed as a good thing. Grizzlies Warriors, 4.7 million in prime time, down 18% from last year. Least watched primetime game since 2016. Well, KC, how are you going to turn this into a positive? Because this is a positive. This should tell Adam Silver it is time to move on from LeBron James. Over the past month, the Lakers have been featured in two of the three most watched games on national television. Now, this was prior to Christmas Day. But that means LeBron James is still the biggest draw. No, because the numbers are shitty. LeBron is drawing almost nothing while the rest of the league is drawing nothing. The NBA features the Lakers and Warriors on national TV damn near every week, if not every week. Going into Christmas Day, ratings for the regular season down 5%, but ratings on League Pass up 60%. So what does that tell you? People are actually paying to watch other stars play. Now, I typically don't like comparing ratings this year to the past 2 years because those numbers are skewed. They were affected by the Fauci. I pulled Christmas ratings from 2018 and 2019. Since those years, the NBA has lost almost 2 million viewers on Christmas. You go back to 2017, the last time they faced competition from the NFL, they've lost almost 1 million viewers. They have not eclipsed 10 million viewers on Christmas Day since 2018. This afternoon, I was searching for a reason as to why the NBA has struggled on Christmas the past couple of years. The conclusion that I came to was actually mentioned in the video from this morning. I pulled ratings from the last 25 years. I wanted to see the five most watched games on Christmas Day. I wanted to see if those five games had anything in common. See if you notice a trend here. Highest rated game on Christmas in NBA history didn't feature Michael Jordan. It was Heat Lakers in 2004, first time Shaq and Kobe played each other after Kobe pushed Shaq out of Los Angeles. Heat Lakers 2010, number two, 13.1 million. This was back when LeBron James had good heat coming off the decision. The Lakers were back-to-back champs. You had the old guard going against the young Bucks. Cavs Warriors 2015, 11.2 million. Bulls-Lakers 2011, 11 million. Heat-Bulls in 97, Michael Jordan's last game on Christmas, almost 11 million. Now, what do all of those games have in common? They gave you a reason to watch. Shaq-Kobe, rivalry. They fucking hated each other. Cavs-Warriors, the beginning of a rivalry. Heat-Lakers, the beloved Kobe Bryant against the hated LeBron James. These are rivalries that we remember 10, 15, 20 years later. We don't have that environment anymore in the NBA. At the end of the day, this is entertainment. You have to give the casual viewer a reason to tune in. Sometimes I will compare the NBA to the UFC because both sports are heavily reliant on star power. You put two UFC fighters in a cage and have them fight for no reason. It's boring to people like me. It's boring to the casual viewer. Now sure, hardcore UFC fans love it, but they're going to be watching regardless. But you put two UFC fighters in the octagon who have personal history, they have animosity, legitimate hatred for each other, you go from 500,000 buys to 1.5-2 million buys on pay-per-view. Go look at the top UFC pay-per-views of all time. McGregor-Khabib, top of the list, 2.4 million buys. Why? They hated each other. It's the same thing in the NBA. Michael Jordan's greatness was captivating television, but what made his career so memorable were all the rivalries. Jordan would make rivals on purpose to motivate himself, but it made for entertaining television. Shaquille O'Neal was also great at doing this. Remember when he called the Sacramento Kings the Sacramento Queens? That one little remark after a game sparked a rivalry. We just don't have that anymore in the NBA. Like I said this morning, these guys would rather be friends than enemies. When is the last time we heard an NBA player talk shit in the media? No one wants to watch friends play a game of grab ass with each other. It's a hell of a lot more entertaining when the game becomes personal. We don't have anyone in the NBA willing to make it personal. Couple that with the fact they were just named the wokest league in America, the ratings are obviously going to struggle. Players are too worried about feelings instead of creating entertaining television. But give me your thoughts. NBA Christmas Day ratings. I think they were disastrous. Most watched game barely eclipses 6 million viewers. Trying to remain positive here, but these ratings suck. What do you think? Sound off in the comments below. Make sure to like and subscribe. Click the notification bell to receive all notifications from the channel. Best way to contact me is by email at btlkc84@gmail.com, kc_btl84 on Twitter. I'll see you guys tomorrow.